Sorry, I understand this late. Okay, good evening, guys. So my name is Prakash. I work in ThoughtWorks. I'm a principal consultant, so basically a technologist, to simply put it. So how many of you work in Java platform? Please raise your hands if you do work in Java platform. Cool. So it is going to be mostly about Java and its platform and its JVM. So if you're working in some other platform, I'm sure you can relate to some of the things I'm saying, right? Like if you're working .NET, a lot of the things I'm going to say, it will be very similar, right? Not same, but it's going to be similar, right? That's what it's going to be about. And I'm sure how many of you are actually developers only, or are you all QAs? Like developers, actually. Yeah, please raise your hands if you're developers. Developers, programmers, you know, architects, basically all of them are developers anyway, right? So most of you are developers anyway, right? So at some point in your development career, you would have dealt with some kind of performance optimizations, right? You would have, yeah, please come. So you would have written code, you would have developed some applications, and you would have had to optimize performance for whatever reasons, right? There may be any reason, right? It may be a website, it may be a backend server, backend APIs, or it can be even mobile app, right? Some kind of performance optimization. So it is going to be about performance optimizations and so on. So before we get into the discussion, right? So from your experience, from your, you know, reading and understanding and so on, what are the factors that kind of impact application performance, right? When you develop a Java application, or even .NET application for that matter, or Ruby application, Python doesn't really matter, right? So what are the things that actually impact performance? Like when you think about performance, right? Now the question would be, when you say performance is bad or performance is good, what do you mean by good or bad? What is that? Expected time, actually. You're expecting some faster response. That is one. What are the other things that you may expect in terms of performance? So when you say your application's performance is good, like, you know, you rightly called out, like you go to, let's say, flipkart.com, and you expect that to load within acceptable, in a human acceptable time, maybe you can say, right? In your perception, it's obviously relative, but it should be fast enough, right? Maybe within a few milliseconds or seconds at the maximum, maybe, right? One is that, yes, latency or response time. What is the other factors that when you say performance is good or bad, what are the other things? Sorry? Resource utilization. The back end, you know, like to support, let's say, Flipkart has, let's say, you know, maybe 100,000 concurrent users, maybe. Are they running like a, you know, big data form, like a Google? Are they able to, you know, serve the same customers with limited resources? Again, you can just, you know, throw like infinite amount of hardware and maybe get the same performance. But are you getting the maximum juice out of the hardware that you have? I think that's, in some ways, that's what it translates to. Are there some other performance indicators? When you say your application's performance is good, what are the other indicators? Sorry? Yeah, memory leaks, but it will translate to something else, right? Leaks is a symptom, actually, right? But in terms of the guest or the customer, how customer will perceive it, right? Or how your system's, you know, performance, how is it measured? Not able to serve many people. Yeah, scalability basically, right? I think indirectly, when we say, are we getting maximum juice out of the hardware we have, in a way we are talking about, you know, are we rightly using the resources? But in a peak day, let's say Flipkart has the big billion day on one single day, and let's say 1 million people are simultaneously, as in concurrently accessing the system, can it serve that many requests, right? And when you talk about scalability, it is always a variable, right? If it is IRCTC, you know, Indian Railway booking, when will be the maximum performance, you know, when will be the load? Tatkal time, on the morning, right? Or maybe the 10 o'clock at 11 o'clock when that booking opens. Again, when will be the peak load in a given year? Festival time, when they open for the festivals, right? So the load on your system, or the expected load, you know, that your system is supposed to serve, will depend on your application, naturally. It's quite obvious, isn't it? Like if it is Flipkart, maybe it's for the festival season. If it is, you know, like US Amazon, like Amazon, they, I think they have the November, you know, yeah, Black Friday and all, like just like their performance is all the effort will go into for that 1 week actually, right? Literally. I mean, I was actually working for one of the US retail companies for their e-commerce platform. The entire like 10 months of effort will go for the 2 months actually, almost literally, right? Because that's actually where they make maximum money out of the sales. So yeah, of course, you know, response latency, scalability, bunch of other things will come into play. Usability and all, of course, that's a different, you know, dimension. It's not about performance, right? So yeah, so we measure the performance in terms of response time, scalability, and other metrics. What are the parameters of your application will impact that? So when you say your application has the performance issues, one of the he called out, you know, memory leaks will impact it. We'll see how it will impact it. But when you try to tune your application, you know, improve your performance of your application or your system, what will you improve generally? You would have seen your experience, right? Something will hurt the performance of your application. What is that something?
Order of N-squared.
Order of?
N-squared. Some loop which is going to
right. So you are basically algorithmic efficiency, you know. Any code you are writing, is it performing enough, you know, performant enough? And what is the order of it, you know, order of, is it order of one? Like, for example, if you access any element in an array, it's actually order of one, right? Versus, let's say you go to a tree, you obviously you can't get an order of one. Then is it like logarithmic performance and so on? In net, I think in simple terms, is your code performant enough? Have you written like, you know, efficient code? That's one. What are the other parameters?
Database.
That's the most obvious, you know, common culprit is database queries, connections, and so on. Again, there are two aspects there, right? The time taken to establish a connection, and the time taken to establish a query, right? And what are the other culprits for performance issues? Sorry?
Garbages.
Can you please elaborate on that? Right. Are you talking about memory leaks or? Right. So if you hold the memory, okay, he's saying if you hold the memory for a long time, it might impact performance. Sure. Okay. What are the other, we'll come to that point. Okay. So we'll revisit that point. So what are the other parameters that may impact the performance? Anything else, like from your experience?
Caching.
Not caching, yeah. Are you caching, like if you have something, let's take an example, right? So there is some news about, you know, somebody, you know, some, let's say, even this 500 rupees is banned, you know, that's a news article. Now it's in the backend server, it's generated. Maybe it's stored in some backend CMS or somewhere, right? Some system. Is it appropriately cached? It's not going to change. Every day, is it going to change? Obviously, it's not going to change, right? Is it cached? And if it is cached, how long it's going to be cached and so on, right? Are we rightly expiring and all is a functional part. But are we caching something which we could have cached, right? Which will actually improve the performance, right? Things like that. There are a bunch of parameters, of course, which impact performance. I listed some of them. Again, it's not comprehensive. Algorithms, DB queries, like time to establish socket connection, you know? It may be for database, it may be for something else, network, HTTP connections, you know, everything. IO. Typical IO, like when you try to read a file from a disk, IO is the most often, you know, the common culprit. Caching, of course, he called out caching. Transport security, are you transporting your payload? When you say payload, anywhere, you know, any content that you transfer, maybe via HTTP, maybe to a database, is it encrypted and sent or it's not encrypted and sent? If you encrypt, obviously there's time spent on encryption and there's time spent on decryption, right? So that obviously affects the performance. I think like even in a best performing network, like in US generally you have best performing, you know, network, right? It typically has some 100 millisecond cost. Now the question may be, is 100 millisecond cost acceptable or not? It depends on the application, right? Like in e-commerce, when we are working on a bunch of APIs, 100 millisecond was actually costly for us, right? But if you are working on maybe IRCTC, I'm sure, you know, like customers will be happy to wait for 100 millisecond. As long as they are actually, you know, able to get the ticket, right? So it's very relative. Okay. So we spoke about a bunch of the parameters that decide the performance. How about JVM? Do you think we should worry about JVM? when we think about performance? Or if you're coming from .NET, do you think we should worry about CLR when we talk about performance? And why should we worry about performance of JVM? Because JVM is anyway, you know, well written, right? So why should we actually worry about JVM's performance? Right. Right. I think if he gets here to him, the point is JVMs are written by obviously collectively by a team. So they brainstorm, they take the best ideas out of, you know, coming out of everyone, even CLR, of course. But they can't imagine all sorts of code that you'll be writing, right? So that's why they allow you to tweak certain parameters. Like if you're working on JVM, there's JVM arguments, which you can always tweak around, right? So you can think about, can we inline the code? Like inlining is one of the common you know, compiler optimizations, right? When you're working on just-in-time compilers, like Java or CLR and all, the code is sometimes interpreted, sometimes, you know, compiled, and the native code is used. So the question would be then, when is it interpreted, when is it compiled? Can we do something about that so that, you know, the frequently used code or frequently accessed code is always, you know, not interpreted, right? Because the more it interprets, it's going to be slow it down, right? Because you are taking a line of instruction, make sense of it, convert to native, you know, the CPU, you know, instruction and execute and all, right? That's one. What are the other things when you think about JVM performance? Basically, the question is more about, should we do something so that our application is performs well in JVM? It's more about that, right? Obviously, JVM's performance, we can't improve on our own, right? But it's more about how do you ensure our application runs effectively or efficiently in a JVM? It's more around that. So some thoughts. So when you talk about JVM, like I think he called out, one of that would be, how do you make the compiler, just-in-time compiler, effectively work on our code, right? And ensure that our code is, you know, kind of serves whatever the needs we have. Depending on the purpose, if it's a client like desktop application, there's a different compiler. If there's a mobile application, different compiler. If there is a backend server application, different compiler. We'll come to that, all of that later, right? That's one dimension to that. The other dimension is memory management. So what is memory management? Generally, I'm sure all of you would have, you know, heard about memory management, right? Like if you have done RAID, you know, like done any programming in C, C++, memory management is the most obvious thing you do. Like anytime you write code, right? Malloc, free, you know, all of those things. What are you doing? When you are allocating memory, you're actually allocating some bytes. How many bytes you tell? You know, if you are getting some, you know, maybe 100 bytes worth of data, you allocate 100 bytes, right? Similarly, at the end of the code, you free the memory. What will happen if you don't free the memory? Yeah, so it's kind of memory leak. Basically, that's what he was calling out in some cases, right? If you ask for memory and then you don't free it by invoking appropriate functions, that memory, the OS thinks your memory is, that memory is still occupied, right? It doesn't give it for something else. So the memory is actually leaked in a way, right? I'm putting it in a very crude way because there are differing on the operating system, depending on the language that we use and all, that a lot of things vary. Yeah. So if you look at this piece of code, it's a C code, right? You don't have to worry about what exactly is happening. Essentially, we are saying, you know, please, you know, read number of items that has to be read. Then we are allocating memory, right? Number of items multiplied by size of int. Depending on the system, it may be 4 bytes or 2 bytes again, right? That's how actually, you know, things are allocated. And that memory, we have pointers for that, right? Yeah, please come. So all that we have done is a very simple program, right? There's no complexity here. All that we have done is we allocated a block of memory here. And we are actually eventually freeing it, isn't it? This is the free part I was talking about, right? If you free it, then the, it's kind of taken back and it'll be given for next set of, you know, usage. Now there is a if condition, there's a branch here, right? There's if condition here. Here we are not freeing it. We're just saying, okay, it's an error condition, right? For some reason, we are not read the minimum amount of required items, then we are returning it. And we are not freed it, which means it's a memory leak, isn't it? It's a very obvious, you know, example that's given whenever people talk about Java and CLR and all, right? You don't have to worry about memory management. And this is exactly what they talk about, right? People make mistakes. Humans do make mistakes. So how do you help the humans so that they easily write programs, right? That's where, of course, the automated garbage collection comes in. What is garbage? Once something is used, it becomes garbage. You create an object. That object has served its purpose. You don't need that object anymore. It's garbage, right? Now, here actually we are clearing the garbage ourselves. And with languages like Java, C sharp and so on, the garbage is actually automatically collected, right? Now, before we go to how Java's memory model works, you know, dealing with garbage and all, right? Let's take a theoretical example, right? Let's say we have our own language. You know, in fact, I believe he is going to talk about some awesome language, I guess. Let's say he designs his own language, right? We need memory. When you have objects, when you have something to store, you need memory, right? You need space to store. Just like we need space for people to sit. If you have objects, you need to have space so that the objects will sit in that space, right? Very simple. So let's say this is the block of space we have got, heap, right? This is a heap we have got. In our theoretical language, and this is our memory model. A block of memory I got, let's say 64 MB, right? Or maybe, I don't know, 1 GB, right? Doesn't really matter what the size is. And as objects are created, it starts filling up the space, right? Naturally. So it's sequentially stored. So it's simple pointer bump up, right? You just increment the pointer, keep storing. If it's like in C, for that's how you'll do. I mean, the language will do. I mean, the runtime will do. We don't, as programmers, you don't do. So it just keeps filling up. Eventually, it's full. Now, the choice is, there are two choices, right? One is the programmer frees the memory on his own, which means as and when it became a garbage, I mean, he kind of clears it up. Or we are designing a new language which kind of does its own automated garbage collection, right? So when it is full, our garbage collector has to kick in and clean up all the unused, right? On all the unused, blocks of space, right? And now, of course, we have only the used objects remaining. So this is it's a very simple theoretical design, you can say. A lot of flaws with this kind of approach, right? There are a lot of issues. Simplistically thinking, imagine this. The more live objects, let's say you have a server application like Tomcat or IIS in .NET world, right? It goes on.
The more objects you scan, it's going to take more time. Very simple. When you have this much objects, you just have to scan this much to decide which is dead, which is alive. And you have the full, all sets of objects, you have to scan the entire area. And it's obviously a function of the amount of area you have to scan, right? It's a very simple mathematics. Which obviously means, let's say you have a Java server application or Cassandra, which is again a Java application. Generally, you tend to allocate more memory. I'm talking about 32 gigabytes of heap size for a Cassandra server, right? And if you had to scan 32 gigabytes, it will be done, but it will be done after the user has long gone back into his home, right? So what do you do? Obviously, you try to design an algorithm which is actually smart. So you start thinking how long objects will live. How long actually objects will live? You take a web application, how long would an object live? A request comes, a request object is created, how long the request object will be alive? Until the response is given,
alive. After it's dead, even the response object is dead, once the response is given to the browser, right? And if you think about it, and people actually, like scientists actually have tried to analyze and, you know, find out, and it has been proven that most objects actually dies short, right? They live very, very short life. And this actually, I took it from this website. Actually, they have very good articles about garbage collection and so on. If this is the object's life, age actually, and the number of objects, as you can see, most of the objects actually die. It's actually, you know, very short life. Some objects live little longer. Examples of those objects would be like connections, database connections, or HTTP connections, right? They don't live like, they don't have eternal life. They do die, but you don't keep killing them often, right? You will actually refresh the connections after a period of time. That period may be 1 hour, period may be 1 day, depends on what the nature of connection is. But they do tend to have medium life. The really long life, the ones like if you have a Java application, again you create a bunch of those controllers and you know backend service objects and so on. They tend to be singleton. They don't die. You don't actually keep killing them, right? Those will eventually will longer. Some of them will die only when you actually kill the application or stop the application itself, right? This is actually a typical object life cycle, you can say. And the all the algorithms actually are designed around this proof, the proof that most of the objects die younger, right? Why waste the energy scanning them? Yeah. Yeah, we'll come to that. Sure. It's shortly it'll be there. Yeah, I think we already spoke about this. Most objects die when they are young. So now let's see how garbage collection is done in JVM, right? How they have designed it. Again, there's no single algorithm, they have multiple algorithms. We'll talk about one hypothetical algorithm, then we'll see, you know, other algorithms later. So this is actually how JVM actually, you know, JVM's heap is kind of, you know, heap layout looks like. So it has, this is the total heap. Let's say we have got 4 gigabytes of RAM for your Tomcat, let's say, right? And it will be sliced into these buckets. And how much of space is given to each of these buckets? We have the control. You have all the levers to decide. What is the space feature of these buckets? What if you don't tell it? The JVM will decide. Based on the runtime heuristics, it will keep adjusting the space. And it will eventually find out, like if you have web application server running for like many days, in few hours, it will find out, okay, this is the right space for this side, right space for this side, and this side and this side and so on, right? High level, it divides the space into young generation and old generation, right? So like we saw here, like this is the young generation objects. And these are actually the objects that are live really long, older generation objects, right? So it has specific space for young, specific space for older. And again, even the young generation is divided into, in Sun's JDK, they call it as Eden. And then they have something called Survivor 1 and Survivor or Survivor 0, Survivor 1. It's a nickname. You can even call, you know, does any name what you want, right? Let's say it's S0 and S2. Sorry, S0 and S1. And that's how it's kind of logically laid out. And what about perm join? I'm sure you would have seen perm join error, out of memory perm join error, right? Perm join is where the class related information will be there. Depending on the Java version, some versions of Java used to even have string pool in that, right? Some versions did not have it, but it's actually outside the heap. Now in Java 8, they replaced it with something called metaspace. We'll go into that later. Unless you're really curious, you can ask me later. Now let's see how the object allocation in JVM will work. So when your application comes up, there are objects getting created. Those objects will start filling up Eden space, right? This is empty, this is empty, this is empty, right? More objects getting filled up, again Eden, again this is empty, this is empty. These are not touched at all. In other words, any new object that is created will only go into the Eden space. Yeah, it is. It is in Sun JDK they call it as Eden. I don't know if in IBM's and other things, I don't know if they still call it as Eden, but it's a very common, I mean, it's a widely used industry term. Yeah. And now, what happens when Eden is full? Obviously, you go on creating so many objects, right? Eden is going to be full at some point. And that's where actually what it is you're, I think, to somebody, I think one of you asked, right? How does it scan all the objects, you know? Does it scan all the objects? If it again scans all these objects, again it's going to be a little dumb, right? It will take more time. So what it does, it is again very smart. It has something called, again it's industry term, GC routes or garbage collection routes. It will start from there. An example of that would be a local variable. Generally, it will be in stack, obviously, right? So all the, wherever the local variable is pointing it, from there it starts. And let's say it is pointing it, you know, this is a local variable. Imagine that, right? This is a customer object. The customer object is pointing at maybe address object. The address object may be pointing at maybe, you know, some street object or whatever, right? And there's a customer object again. There's another object, again, it's pointing at maybe the customer's transaction details and so on, right? And that may be again cross-referencing, right? It goes here and it's like one object is referring to other. Again, we take this another local variable. Again, this point has it's referring to these two objects. This object is referring to this, sorry, this, and so on. You get what I'm saying, right? It's actually a web of objects. One object is referring to the other objects or maybe referring to a bunch of other objects. It just traverses that path and marks all those objects as live objects. Right, which means everything else is dead object, isn't it? Now, is it only local object it has to worry about? No, there are more things it has to worry about. It has to worry about method variables. Again, it's a local variable only. If you are passing something to a method or a function, again, that's a variable, right? It may be pointing at an object. So it has to worry about that. It has to worry about static variables. And it has to worry about threads. Like, you start an application, it's a main thread, you spawn again another thread, the variables inside that are in the thread scope, right? So it has to worry about these things and maybe some couple of other things also, but let's not worry about that. Essentially, our GC collector will start from these pointers or these nodes, right? And then traverses the entire web of objects, and wherever it can reach, it marks all those objects as live. Everything else is considered to be dead. And there's one more point to think about. If your application is running, you have a web application, there are hundreds of requests coming, which means request objects are getting created, response objects are getting created, and so on. Will your GC thread be able to scan it? If a garbage collector is running, again, it will run in a thread, isn't it? Again, Java, everything is a thread, isn't it? So your GC also has a thread, and I mean, it has to run in a thread. As it is scanning, if the requests are coming and more objects are getting created, obviously it will go crazy, right? It wouldn't know what is again live again, right? So what they do to prevent such, you know, confusions and incorrectness, actually, to be precise, they block your application threads. All your application threads will be blocked, which means any requests coming in, that will have to wait, right? And that's called safe point. Basically, safe point is a point at which the application is blocked for something, for doing something. One of the most often reason why a safe point is created is for garbage collection, right? And they call this, anytime the garbage collection happens, right, they call it as stop the world process, STW. It's industry term. Stop the world process. They pause all the your application requests and they clean the garbage, right? And when you clean the Eden, and that's called minor GC, minor garbage collection. It, like I said, it goes over the garbage GC routes, garbage collection routes, identifies all the live objects which are in green, everything else is considered to be dead. The gray ones are considered to be dead. What it does, it copies over all the live ones to survivor space, S0. Yeah? It's called mark and copy. Essentially, it marked all the live objects and copies to survivor space. So all the live ones are here. So what happened to all the objects here? Those bytes are still there. But does it really have to go and wipe out something? It's not like a board where it has to go and wipe out, right? It just needs to clean up its register saying, I'm going to start afresh. It just needs to start overwriting the bytes here, right? So all that it is, the entire space is considered to be empty. Though there may be some bits already there, but it just has to overwrite it, that's all, right? It doesn't have to, again, you know, it's not like a board where it has to wipe it, right? Again, same thing happens. More objects, more requests come in. Eden is going to start getting filled. And once it is full, what will happen? Again, minus GC will kick in, right? What does minus GC do? Again, it will mark all those live objects. But this time, because there are objects in survivor space, S0, it will check those live objects as well. And it will mark those live objects as well. Because in the meantime, when it was filling up the Eden, some of these objects would have been dead. Yeah? So what it does, it checks all those live objects, and then it will copy all those live objects from Eden and also from the S0. At this time it's called from space, right? From survivor space to survivor space or S1. So far good. Any questions? Anybody has any questions? So GC does three different things depending on the situation. It'll be mark and copy, mark and sweep, and mark and sweep and compact also. We'll come to that. Because sweeping is really sweeping, by the way. This one you're talking about? Yeah. Reference will be there in the stack as long as the method scope is there. Once the method is executed, the stack, again, the stack will get cleared off, right? Green ones are the stack variables, static variables, and so on. Correct. Yeah, sure. So, yeah, essentially, any of these things, like local variable, again, local variable is something, either you declare something inside a method, or something is passed to a method, right? Method parameters, or a static variable, or again, things that are actually, you know, created as part of thread execution. Those are the considered GC rules. And let's say your local variable is called customer. So this is pointing at customer, right? And let's say this is the customer, right? The customer is maybe pointing at address. And by in your design, maybe address is again pointing back at customer. Right? That's why the arrows are bidimensional, right? And if you take this example, this is probably a more complex web of objects. Right? Maybe an order in an e-commerce system. And order is pointing at maybe order items. Order item is pointing at maybe, you know, its own set of item details. Like if it's a washing machine, its own dimensions and so on. So there's a web of objects like that. Again, order will have something else also, right? Maybe some order ID, again, some more things, right? So it just has to traverse this graph of objects and mark all of them live, right? The moment it's marked everything that is live as live, everything else is dead. It's a very simple, you know, thing they are done, right? So everything else, the gray ones are dead. Again, they don't go kill, wipe, or anything, right? They're just smart. What they do is, they just copy the live ones here and consider the entire space as empty. Very simple. Yeah? Live objects are marked. Correct. Eden is more older than Surveyor. No, the objects are always allocated in Eden. When a request comes to your application, let's say it's a web application, it's an example, right? The request object will be going into the Eden, right? Sorry? How will it be? Because objects will always go to Eden first. And then you go to Surveyor, right? Surveyor, nothing goes to Surveyor directly. Like I said, right, when we started, it always goes to Eden. Only when Eden is full, the minor GC kicks in. Until then, this is empty, this is empty, this is empty. No, it's incorrect. And there are actually 2-3 very good Java performance books also, right? Actually, and if you check Amazon.com ratings and all, right? I'll tell the books also, I'll share later. And there are very good explanations around all of that. If it is saying like that, it is actually incorrect. Hmm? It always goes to Eden. Hmm? Yeah. Correct. Yeah, it is just simply, see, at the end of the day, it's all bits, right? 0 or 1. And there is a register kept separately, which tells up to what point, you know, what point, up to what point it's actually occupied, isn't it? It just had to update the register saying, now, by the way, this is empty. Doesn't it really have to go and reset all the ones to zeros or anything, right? Okay, so this cycle goes on. So, like I said, you know, the second cycle, what happened? The object is already in from space, so all the live objects will come to the two space. Now the two space, which was two space, this is again another Surveyor space. All the live objects are copied here. Now this is considered empty, this is empty, and this is empty. Yeah. Now the application runs again. It starts filling up. GC kicks in, minor GC. This time, this is considered from space. The reason why I put all these terminologies is, if you read in internet, blogs or anything, book or anything, they'll always use the same vocabularies. Yeah. So in summary, as you can imagine, these two Surveyor spaces keep interchanging their roles. When this is occupied, this is called from space. So during next minor GC, this is where the objects will be copied to. Yeah. And again, the next cycle will actually toggle, right, interchange their roles. So these live objects come here, these live objects go there. And these are actually the live objects now. Again, same thing happens, cycle continues. So what happens here? I mean, does something come here at all, right? If the cycle just goes on and on and on, what happens? So when will something come here? So one possibility is, like you said, we allocated some space, maybe say 1 GB space, but we have created more objects than 1 GB can accommodate. Then it will overflow and go here. So overflow is an exceptional case. It's not a normal case, but overflow will happen. Specifically, when the application starts up, the lot of objects will be created. So that time overflow will definitely happen, right? When the application, when you bring up your server, that time it will happen, right? Yeah. It'll happen like this, right? From Eden, it'll try to copy to Surveyor, but Surveyor only doesn't fit, you know, doesn't have enough capacity. It'll be directly pushed to older. But again, like I said, it's a overflow case. It's exceptional case. It's not a normal case, right? So what is a normal case? So that's where the concept of object age comes in. So we are talking about, yeah. Yeah, can you ask me the same question again? When I'm going to show a demo briefly. At that time, can you ask me? I'll just show that. So, we said this is younger generation, and this is older generation, right? So, just like human beings are considered older beyond a point, right? It's very similar. So one GC, when one minor GC happens, if the object survive, what does it mean to say survive? They are alive. The age is considered to be one. Yeah. Second minor GC happens, the objects are still alive. The age is considered to be two. Third, fourth, and so on. Then when do they move to the older? We tell when it should move. Yeah. If you don't tell, it is 15. When the age is 15, it is considered to be older, right? 15 is maximum in Java platform, JVM, modern JVM. 15 is maximum age of an object, beyond which the object will be pushed to older generation. Should we define? We should. If you want highly performant applications, we should. When, how, and all, I'll tell you. But there's a parameter. There's a JVM argument you can pass. Something called maximum max tenuring threshold. And if you say 6, when the age is 6, it will move to older generation, right? Okay, yeah, let's look at the very, very brief demo, just to kind of illustrate that, right? I don't know if you use something called the JVisual VM or Visual VM. It's actually packaged along with your JDK, right? If you go check your tools bin, you can see this one. It's actually JConsole, JVisual VM, all these tools are there as part of your JDK. What I have is a very simple, it's a very dummy program, right? All that it does is, it generates garbage, it doesn't do anything useful, right? Because the session is about garbage, right? So I have to create garbage. So the code is like this. It runs in a loop, I think for 10 million times. And just to simulate, yeah. Yeah, plus didn't work, so I'm just a second, will be done. Okay. Oh, okay. All right. So it does nothing, right? Seriously, all that it is, it runs in a loop and creates some string, random strings, and then sleeps for 50 milliseconds. Again, runs the loop, right? Basically, it generates garbage. Nothing else. Yeah. Some garbage that will run longer. How does it stay longer? Because I am storing the garbage in an array. Array is again a static variable. I cycle that using mod, right? Beyond a point, again it will cycle back. So on beyond a point, it will again become dead, right? It's a very simple program which generates garbage. So let's run that. I'm just running it here. Right. So now to your question, right? How do we specify these regions? So how do we specify these regions, right? JVM, if you don't specify, it will heuristically determine on its own. But if you want to have finer control, then you use all these levers you have, the JVM arguments, right? XMS is the minimum heap size you want. XMX is the maximum. Like here I'm saying 64 MB. In the server applications, it will be in gigabytes, right? Not in megabytes. Generally, if you want to have finer control, you will probably set both minimum and maximum to be same. Otherwise, what will happen in the initial period, it will heuristically try to adjust. You know, it will start with minimum, and then if it realizes it needs max, you know, more and more, it will start adjusting, right? So it does have some performance penalty. XMN. You see the XMN, and that is actually the new generation or younger generation, and this is the XMN. Out of the total heap, what is XMN? So what we have said here, out of total heap size of 64 MB maximum, 32 MB goes to new generation. The norm is you start with 40%. That's a convention. You start with 40%, you run performance tests, then you start optimizing, you start adjusting, right? Then what is, how much is this space? How is it decided? Again, there's another parameter for that. There's something called survivor ratio. So one eighth of the younger generation will be given to this. So this is actually one eighth of this space. Again, this is one eighth of that space, right? And that's how you control. Did it answer your question? it'll decide based on how your hardware capabilities. If you, yeah, it will be based on your the bunch of things decided, right? How many garbage collector threads actually? Garbage collection is again run in a thread, right? Normally in a server grade application, there will be multiple threads doing garbage collection. So how many threads have to do garbage collection? How much memory to be allocated? How much memory to be given for younger generation, older, everything is heuristically determined, again based on your hardware capabilities. If you are really, really high grade server, then it will be more. Alright, so let's run this. Right, I'm running the application. I may send the output to another log file so that it doesn't clutter this shell. Let's see the. I'm also printing the GC garbage collector logs. So you can print the garbage collection. When the garbage collection happens, the most accurate way to know how well your garbage collector is performing is to look into garbage collection logs. Yeah, that's the most accurate you can get to. So the way you again see here, I am specifying the file name log gc and you tell what to print, you know, timestamps, you print, you know, tenuring distribution, bunch of those things. I'll talk about it. See, this is actually how a garbage collection log will look. Depending on the collector algorithm that you choose, the log file will change, right? This is actually for serial collector. The serial collector is the simplest collector you can choose, right? And let's take an example, right? This is one minor GC. That what I have highlighted here is the log meant for one minor GC. Yeah? And here, see the age here. Age 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So what I have done here, maximum tenuring threshold, the one you see in the right side top, I specified it to be 6, right? So what it means is, when the objects reach life of 6, they'll get promoted to older generation. Yeah. So again, coming back here, so I'll just mount this in Visual VM. The good thing with this is, you know, visually, I mean, there are some plugins you can look into that. See this one, right? Like objects are filling up Eden. This is actually Eden. For some reason, I couldn't, kind of stretch it out. So it keeps filling up Eden. And you watch this space. It'll keep toggling between two survivor spaces. When the minor GC kicks in, it'll come here. Again, minor GC kicks in, it goes there. And this is typically the amount of memory. Again, minus GC kicked in, again 0. It fills, again kicks in, right? What this is again a known pattern, what they call a saw teeth pattern, right? How a saw teeth will look like, right? Saw teeth pattern. And this actually means your GC is very healthy, but you have to look at the actual numbers, like time to determine if it's healthy or not. Yeah. Older generation, yeah, it got pushed actually. See this one, right? Yeah, I forgot to say this one. So it said the tenuring threshold to be 6. So if you can see in the histogram, this is actually life of objects, right? How many objects are in 4? How many objects are in age, say, 5 and so on? It won't cross 6 because we have set it to 6, right? So you can see these are the objects actually, amount of objects in 6, 5 and so on, right? Once they cross that life, it will go to the older gen. So there are so much objects that have gone to older gen. Any questions on this? So another point, at any point in time, only one server space will be used. Another one will be empty because during the next minor GC, the live objects have to be copied to the empty space again, right? All right. If there are no questions, I'll proceed for that. Yeah, we saw older objects older generation space having the objects, like more objects here. Again, the same cycle continues, goes on and on and on. The objects that are surveyed during the tenuring threshold will like be actually promoted. It's called promotion, object promotion, right? They will be promoted to the older generation. Again, let's say older generation also keeps filling up. If it reaches this much, maybe there's again depends on the application. If you have a backend cache, you know, the cache may have different set of nature of objects compared to a web server, web application, compared to a desktop application. So there's no single set of configurations for you know, for all the applications. Let's say promotion also fails. When will promotion fail? Older generation is full, minor DC kicks in, and some of these objects have reached the tenure or age of 6 or whatever you specify. They had to be promoted, but there's no space. So there is a promotion failure. So what will happen? So again, that has to be cleaned up, right? So I had the fine print here. Depending on the algorithm you choose, it may not always wait for that to be full, right? Like in algorithm like CMS, which we'll cover later again, the percentage you can specify. Once it is 70%, in parallel it'll keep doing garbage collection and all, right? But just to keep it simple, I kept, you know, I said if it's full, it will be promoted, it will be cleaned up. So that's where the mock and sweep comes in, actually the one you are pointing at, right? So in younger generation, this minor GC is always mock and copy, meaning it will mark all the live objects and copy over to two surveyor space. It's never no sweeping, nothing, right? The older generation, depending on the algorithm, things will vary. But the most important thing is, it will mark all the live objects, and it will clean up its register saying these spaces are blank. Why so? Because most of the objects in older generation will definitely live longer, right? So there's no point again, you know, trying to look only for live objects and trying to retain them. Here the algorithm operates a little differently. Most of the objects will be living longer, right? And that's the reason why it just cleans up the remaining empty space. It makes the remaining ones as empty. After minor GC, will it be like this? Well, it depends on one thing. After minor GC, how will an object be that was here come here? It won't automatically come, will it? Because we just cleaned up only the data objects, isn't it? So I'll talk about that. So what is full GC? There's a term that will come across again in the blogs and books and so on, something called full GC. There's no official vocabulary called full GC, but by convention, when there is a situation like this, this is full, minor GC has to kick in. But for that, major GC has to kick in first. So major GC will kick in. Once that is done, this also has to kick in, right? So when everything is cleaned up, generally they call it as full GC, right? And when the full GC kicks in, it will also clean up the meta space also. I mean the permgen space, you know, where classes are stored. Now we'll talk about the fragmentation, right? So when you have a situation like this, after you wipe all the data objects, the live objects will be here, isn't it? It won't suddenly change. Where will they go? They'll be here only, isn't it? Now, there are two possibilities. Then other objects that get promoted can start filling up this space. Quite possible, right? The other option is you compact. You copy all the live objects to one area and start filling up the remaining area, right? Again, in JVM, depending on the algorithm, both the types are actually in practice. Again, there are downsides to both the options, right? Here, when you try to compact, there's a time taken for compaction, isn't it? The live objects have to be copied over here. But that's like one-time cost. Later, once the old gen is done, it just has to start copying over here, right? Like a pointer bump up, right? In the other case, it'll start filling up, but there's a logic to be executed, right? It has to check the register to find out which is the empty slot, A, B, will it fit that empty slot, Let's say there is, you know, 2 MB of space here. You are creating an object which is like 2 MB, 2.5 MB maybe, right? Obviously, it won't fit here. Maybe then it will have to, you know, go somewhere here, 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 and so on, right? So there is some efficiency, you know, the compromise is there, right? So far, any questions on major GC, minor GC, or GC overall? So it will, like, we are talking about GC routes, right? All are like, yeah, as long as the graph, the ones it traverses, everything is live, which means everything else is dead. That's how, yeah, it's a simple algorithm in some ways. Yeah, in fact, depending on the algorithm we choose, like ones in like CMS, G1 and all, which is actually the most popular ones, it's very rare, like in the typical web application, it's very rare to have a major GC. So minor GC will happen often. You can also configure, when major GC happens, I want minor GC to be compulsorily done. You can also say that. But is it compulsory that major GC happens, minor GC has to happen? No, it's not like that. Like in an algorithm like CMS, you can say when the world generation space is 70% full or 50% full, you decide what the number is. Then you parallelly start working on GC, right? So because it's not full, the major GC triggers at different points. Yeah. That will be? No, when it's full. Correct. Yeah, you're right. But the thing is that I was talking about the overflow situation, right? Let's say minor GC kicks in. It tries to clean it. But still there's not enough space in Survivor for all those live objects to be moved. Then it will be directly promoted to older generation. And typically that will happen in every or most of the applications that will happen when the application comes up. Because when like if you take a web application or an API based application, any backend application, traditionally if you see, right, lot of those initial objects will be created. Connections will be established, controller objects will be, singleton objects will be created and so on. So there will be lot of those object generations and all of them will be or most of them will be long living. So they will be directly pushed actually. Okay, so if you are good so far, so the Eden space we spoke about is not a single block of space. Again, that is divided into something called T-labs. So why is that? Again, let's take a simple web application example. Flipkart, 100 requests are coming, which means 100 threads are operating maybe, right? Let's say in Tomcat, you define more threads. There are 100 threads. If you allow all those threads to access this area, there will be conflict, right? One thread will be trying to write this area into this area. The other thread also will not be aware that it has to write it, you know, other thread is writing, right? There has to be some inter-thread communication has to happen so that it doesn't, there's no conflict. One doesn't override the other, right? Which means the efficiency is again gone, right? There'll be some cost to that. So what they do, they slice the Eden area into multiple T-labs, thread, local allocation buffer, T-lab, right? So each of the slices is given to one thread. Yeah, one thread. So his request comes in and he's given his own thread. That thread will use this space. And let's say his request comes in. It will not, obviously, because it has its own slice, right? It will go into that slice. Now what happens, this is full. Then it will go into something called common Eden area. It will go to common area. Right? And what happens even that is full, minor GC will kick in. Very simple. Yeah, that each thread is allocated its own space, right? So the GC sorry, the JVM will go on it in such a way. Let's say thread name is thread 1. And in its register, it will know thread 1 is given this address space. Right? Thread 2 will be given this address space. Right? So JVM will take care of it. Right? So now coming to the GC algorithms. Like I said when I started, Java it was like long ago, maybe they had some one algorithm, right? So they have 4 algorithms. Again, there's a young generation garbage collector, there's an old generation collector. And how do you enable that algorithm? This is the argument you give, right? So for example, in this case, so if I go to the command line, see this one. So I given that use serial GC, right? Here I am saying please enable serial collector. So like serial, we have parallel. It's also called as throughput collector, CMS, G1. So all these 3 are popular ones. This is like the weakest or very least used one. So what is serial collector? Serial means obviously not parallel, which means single thread. In other words, this entire area will be cleaned up by only one thread. It will do the job, it will take more time. Let's say you have some 16 core machine, right? So there will be minimum 16 threads, depending on whether you have hyper thread or not, right? So all those remaining 15 threads, what will be doing? Sitting idle. No work is done. Of course, there will be some work for OS, but other than that, no other work is there. Only one thread is doing the job, which means it's a function of, it will take more time, obviously, right? So when will you use serial? So if you have very low-end hardware, very like you just have a 2-core machine maybe, right? Things like that. There may be some scenarios like that, either because it's a desktop or maybe, some very constrained environments, serial will be used. Parallel CMS and G1 will be used in most of the server applications. G1 is specifically meant for really large heap sizes. Like Cassandra, for example, one application I was part of previously, the platform, we had 32, is it 32? Yeah, it was 32 gigabytes RAM, sorry, heap actually, right? It was 32 gigabytes heap. The number of threads used for garbage collection were 24. Again, because the number of cores were 32 core machine, right? Basically 16 dual core machine. 16 dual core meaning 32 cores, right? So it's really high end, or even high end machines are there. Generally, when you have large caches, maybe 256 gigabytes RAM, heap, 512 gigabytes heap, and so on, right? Those situations, G1 is the ideal one. Currently, G1 is not the default, but I believe Java 9 are going to make G1 as the default one. CMS, between these two, there's a reason why you would choose one over the other. We'll talk about that later. For now, we'll just see serial is for younger generation, it is mark and copy. Well, actually, for all these algorithms, right, all these algorithms you have, this is actually the collectors, right? All of them use for younger generation mark and copy. Mark the live object and copy over to two space. There's no difference. Only in older generation, the algorithm changes. For serial, it is actually mark, sweep, and compact. Meaning, if you have older generation lot of objects, you mark all those live objects, right? Clean up the unused ones, dead ones, then compact. Basically, copy over everything to one place so that next time onwards, the allocation becomes easier. That is serial. And how do you enable the logs, right? I was showing the logs, GC logs. How do you enable it? To enable this log, you just give these details. Anyway, command line arguments and all, you can always Google and find out, right? Nothing to remember and all. One last bit in the logs. So what is this one? So this is the, it just keeps moving. So I'll move it to, okay. didn't copy everything. Come on. This keeps moving. Yeah. So if we look into the highlighted region, right? Sorry, this one. This is actually the time at which GC kicked in. This is seconds since the JVM was started or your application was started. This is indicating it's, you know, minus GC. Why did it occur? Because allocation failure. As in meaning Eden was full. Def new is the minus GC collector name in serial algorithm, right? Again, if you go to CMS, the name will change. Desired services and all, I think we already spoke about that. And this many bytes are there in with age so much. Like in the age one, you have 2,10,896 bytes. Age two, and so on, right? Generally, when you are running some performance tests for GC optimization, enabling all these logs actually really help. Yeah. And the last bit, this is the younger generation space total. This was before garbage collection. This is after garbage collection. Yeah. And this is actually total heap size. It was, you know, close to 64 MB. This is total occupied before GC. This is total occupied after GC. And this is the time taken, right? This is like the user time of CPU, system time for CPU. As in when GC thread runs, how long the thread actually, you know, how much, like let's say you have two threads are running. One thread took 5 milliseconds, other thread took, you know, 10 milliseconds. In user space, as in its own garbage collection code. So 5 plus 10, 15 milliseconds. System space is, let's say garbage collector thread makes some OS calls, right? How long that took? Real is actually in clock time. There may be multiple threads running. So each thread took like say 5 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds and so on. But net actually, what is the clock time, right? Maybe 5 milliseconds and so on, right? That's actually at a high level of how GC logs look. I'm not going to cover the other algorithms because that may be a little overwhelming now. We will talk about it maybe as part of next one or the one after that or, you know, in future sessions, right? I just said, you know, SQL continues. It's not just GC. We will talk about some more, like he was talking about the, you know, compiler. How do you tune your compiler also, right? How do you can say it's just JIT compiler. Is it enough just to say, you know, yeah, JIT compiler will take care of it? Do you do certain things so that, you know, like you were talking about, do you inline or not and so on, right? We'll talk about it. I don't know if it will be done in next one session or one after the other, but we'll see. In summary, it's done. Any questions you guys have? Anybody has any questions? Otherwise, I'm kind of done. Yeah. Thank you, guys.